Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Cocktails After Dark. I've been a little bit busy lately, and I haven't been keeping up with cocktail videos. I've been rebuilding or restoring an airplane over on our other channel, and that has taken up a lot of my time. So by the time this video actually makes it onto YouTube, I'm going to say probably every other cocktail channel on YouTube has covered this. But I still want to go through it. I still want to go through it because I think I can add some historical context to what's going on here. And that's this idea of superjuice. So we started seeing rumblings about this superjuice idea, what's called superjuice, about the end of 2019, early 2020 is when I first started hearing about it. And you can trace it back to a guy named Nickel Morris. And Nickel is a co-owner of a bar. And he was looking at ways to better utilize the ingredients at his bar. And that's, most of it is citrus. And how can he, and how could his bar staff, you know, use it more responsibly, get more out of it? And the knock-on effect to that is give a better experience to their customer and save some money. And he came up with this idea of superjuice. Now, I know that every cocktail recipe channel is doing this. I encourage you, and I will link to them down below, to go back and watch these talks that Nickel Morris gives about how he came up with superjuice, how he came up with this idea and the experimentation that led to this and the research that led to this. He was able to take a whole bunch of ideas down through time and sort of round them up, bring them together, envision what had to happen, and then made it happen. So he's taken something that goes back all the way into the 1800s, the early 1800s, and we'll talk about that, and made something new that in, you know, 2022 is incredibly relevant and works very well. So the history behind this idea of using the peels to get most of the flavor, that is where most of the flavor in citrus is in the peels. It's in the oil in the peels. Goes back, way back. So, just in our own experience on this channel, I don't know, 2 or 3 years ago on the old cookbook show, the show that we do on Sunday morning, we did something for Orange Aid. And this was a Depression era, 1930s Depression era recipe from here in Ontario where we live, where people would get citrus once a year and they would buy a box of citrus and then have to preserve the juice through the winter. And if you look at that recipe, and I'll link to that down below again, you start out with something where we peeled the citrus, we put the peels in a crock with citric acid and sugar. So we're making a combination of an oleo acid and an oleosaccharum. Oleosaccharum is a very old term that just means oil and sugar. And in the 1850s, you were making oleosaccharum by putting peels and sugar together, and the sugar pulls the oils out of the peels, and then you use that oil to flavor everything, and it gives a really strong flavor. So this 1930s Depression era recipe for Orange Aid is an acid, sugar, and water put together with the peels first to pull out the oils, and then you add the juice in, and then you strain the whole thing out. And so this is where Nickel is working from. Like he's looking at these recipes and saying, okay, so what can I do to really amp up that flavor? Now, when we go back to this stack of books here from the 1850s, there's two here in particular that I want to talk about. So this one on top is Jerry Thomas's Bartender's Guide. And in the back, he's got a couple of things for essence of lemon and lemon syrup. And he's using gum syrup, which is sugar water, tartaric acid, and oil of lemon in order to make this lemon syrup. And the idea, he talks about this a little bit in the other part of the book, the idea is that, you know, in the 1850s, fresh citrus shows up in a very short period of time, but the rest of the year, you still need these flavorings to make the cocktails. And so this was a way of extending the shelf life, giving something that was bright and flavorful that you could use all year long. And so he was using tartaric acid, which is this one right here. And tartaric acid, you probably know it by another name, cream of tartar. You use that in baking a lot. And this other book here, again, from the 1850s, they have a lemon cordial. Slightly a little bit different because it is sweeter. Again, both of these use a sweetener. But it's the same sort of idea. It's syrup, water, water and sugar, water, citric acid, and essence of lemon. And in both of these cases, when they're talking about essence or oil, they're really talking about essential oils, and that is the distilled oils from the peel of the citrus. And so they're using slightly different acids. What Nicol came up with was that in the peel of the lime, there are two acids that you really want to bump up that will improve the flavor, enhance the flavor. And that's citric acid and malic acid. And those two acids in combination, which are already there, sort of enhance the entire thing and stabilize it for a little bit better shelf life. This is not, however, what you're probably thinking of. Everybody's brain is probably going to the same place. And that's Rose's lime cordial. This stuff is water, sugar, glucose, concentrated lime juice, citric acid, natural flavoring, sulfites, and color. The color really puts me off. Definitely the color puts me off. And the natural flavoring is probably, more than likely, something like essential oils. They're just telling you that it's a flavoring because that's all they really have to tell you. But the flavor is horrible. This stuff is much better. So I'm just using a vegetable peeler to peel the limes. You want to leave behind as much of the pith as you can. It might be a little bit difficult, but you know, do your best. Now, I'm only doing 5 limes today. You can imagine that on the scale of a busy bar on a Friday or Saturday night, they would do a lot of limes. I'm only going to do 5. And I look at this from the standpoint of if you're having a cocktail party around your house, or you're someone who enjoys cocktails on a regular basis, this is something that you could make up ahead of time and have in the fridge. It keeps for quite a while. Zero it out, and we'll weigh the peels. So I've got 45 grams of peels. So based on the weight of the peels, a little bit of math tells me I need 18 grams of citric acid. So I zero out the scale, and I'll just sprinkle this in slowly to make sure that I don't overdo it. 5. 10. So 18 grams of citric acid, new spoon, and malic acid. And the malic acid, I need 13.5 grams of malic acid. So, and this is food grade malic acid. I get this from the same company that I get some of my brewing adjuncts from. So there's 5, 10, 13.5. There we go. Now, I'm going to put the lid on this and shake it up and make sure that the acid is completely covering those peels. And almost immediately, you'll see that it's getting wet inside. The acid's going to pull those oils out of the peel. And that oil is the flavor, like I said before. So just shake that up. You could get in there with a muddler if you wanted to. So what I'll do at this point is just leave it on the counter for 4 or 5 hours, let the acids do their work, and we'll come back with the next step. I gotta tell you, the aroma of lime in this kitchen is over the top. Now, you'll see, it'll be hard to see through the plastic on this, but the acids have pulled a lot of oil out of those peels. So I'm gonna tip them into this blender. Based on the weight of the peels, I need 720 milliliters of water. And so I'm going to pour some of that into here so that we can get all of the oil and the acid that's stuck to the inside. Put that in, rest of the water, and then we liquefy. Okay, now, depending on your blender, I mean, you could do this with a stick blender. I've seen people do it that way. BlendTec blends really, really fine. An amazing blender for this sort of thing. Depending on how you're blending it or what you're doing to blend it, maybe zesting the limes at the beginning could be a good idea because your blender may not be able to get it as fine as it is. or as I did here. So the idea is now that we strain out the little bits of pulp. You want it to be nice and smooth. You want it to be completely clear. You could, I imagine, at this point, now that it's blended, let it sit for another 25 or 30 minutes just to make sure that the acid has pulled all of that flavor out of the peels. I think I might do that. Let's let this sit for another 25 or 30 minutes and get the full effect. In the meantime, I will juice these limes because we need the juice for later. So out of those five limes, I got 125 mils of lime juice. Now we're going to hold on to that. This is just the peel and the acid and a little bit of water. Now the idea is that you want to strain it out. So I'm going to do that. I've got here, I think most people would call this a nut milk bag. I use it down in the brewery for brewing beer and straining things out of the beer that I don't want in them anymore. So get all of the juice out that we can. Now what's in this jug is the oleo acid, oil, acid, water, and it is essentially stable-ish. I would imagine that this would keep in a sealed container somewhere cool and dark for a very long time. And cool and dark, you know, the easiest cool and dark place that you have is your refrigerator. And so that will keep for almost forever. You add this in to make that super juice. But I imagine this on its own could be used just the way it is. Let's see. Tart, very tart. A little bit bitter, just a tiny little bit bitter. And that's from the pith. That's from the pith. Maybe I left a little bit too much on the peel when I put it into the blender. But very tart. And some of that tartness is coming from these two acids that we added. And those acids were already in the peel. So it's not like we're adding something completely different. We're adding in more of what was already there. We're enhancing what was already there. So to make this super juice, just add the lime juice back in. And we'll give that a bit of a stir. And I think I'll mix up a cocktail that uses lime juice. We'll get Julie in here and we'll give it a try. And we'll try this against fresh juice and see what happens. Now I'm gonna run through a very quick cocktail, a simple gin sour. And I'm gonna do a gin sour from this cocktail book that I'm gonna come back to again and again and again, because I think this is a very pivotal cocktail book. Published in 1948. It's called The Fine Art of Mixing Drinks by David Embry. This is a copy that is actually signed by the author. And it is one of the most detailed cocktail books from this time period. In fact, the most detailed cocktail book from this time period. And he has some incredibly strong opinions about how things are supposed to be made. And the one opinion that he just nails home over and over and over and over and over again is that you have to use fresh juice. If you're not using fresh juice, unadulterated, fresh, squozen, just before it goes in the cocktail, then you're doing your guests an incredible disservice. So we're going to start out. I'm going to use gin, and each of these gets 2 ounces of gin. So this is a Dylan's rye-based gin that I really like. Why not use something that I enjoy, and we'll see how this works out. Next in is 1/4 ounce of simple syrup in each one. So in with the simple syrup. And 1/2 ounce of lime juice. Now, super juice on the right. Super juice on the right. New jigger so I don't cross-contaminate. And freshly squozen on the left. Freshly squozen on the left. Ice the shaker. One at a time. Okay, and this is the freshly frozen juice. Get a Nick and Nora and double strain. Okay, so there we go.
Perfect. I'm here in time. Hi, friends.
Hey, Glen.
It has a very limey smell, like very citrusy. I don't know if lime's the right word, but
so citrusy.
I think I was influenced by the limes here.
So you've got two cocktails in front of us.
Okay.
One variable between the two.
Slightly different color.
They are slightly different color.
Okay.
Let's give it a.
Oh, sorry. I was so enthusiastic to smell it.
Oh. So it is. It's a gin sour.
Really. Okay. Just with so much lime, I was just, you know, curious about what it would smell. It's not, the aroma around the room is very lime smelling, but the drink itself is just right.
Okay. I don't know what to think. So you have no clue which is which.
I end up having to drink the whole thing just to try and see if there's there is not a significant difference. I feel like this one seems a little sweeter.
Yes. This one is much limey. This one has...
Yeah, this one seems a little sweeter. This one might be a little more citrusy.
Acidic.
Maybe acidic?
Yeah.
Yeah, because it doesn't feel like there's any flavor change. Like, there isn't a distinct flavor difference, but there's something a little bit different.
There's a little bit different between them.
This one's, and maybe that's why... Okay. It's hard to get the right words for all the different flavors, citrus, you know, acidic. Yeah. There isn't a huge difference, though. Like, you've got a really... I feel like I needed a drink in between.
Okay. Now.
They're pretty they're, identical.
They're both great.
Yeah. They're both a classic kind of gin sour.
So as I read this book by... as I read this book, I will scream out because it's written in a very ham-fisted way. He expresses some very strong opinions, some that I agree with and some that I just were like, whatever. One of his strong opinions really is that you only can use freshly squozen juice. If you're not using juice, it's squozen right into the shaker. Forget about it. And never use something out of a bottle or a can. For the most part, I would agree with him. But that's super juice.
Yes. So, based on the older way of
preserving lemons and limes. Yeah.
Limes and, yeah.
I don't know that if I was presented with either of these, I would say that one was better than the other.
And I wonder if at the time, well, no, he wrote that a long time ago, probably before the little plastic lemon or lime that used to be in the fridge.
So that's 1948. Yes.
Right.
And as you go through history, when you're in the 1800s with these cocktail books, they talk about using preserved juices and making a preserved juice from the oil of, you know, you would buy a jug of
the oil. You
wouldn't
have a choice.
No, you wouldn't have a choice.
There's no, it's like this is when.
And then it swings completely to the other side where it can only be fresh with a lot of waste. And now we're sort of swinging back with this, with Nicol Morris saying this will keep for a couple of weeks in your fridge, uses more of the lime, you get more juice, more bang for your buck.
And limes aren't cheap anymore.
No, limes aren't. They were 75 cents each today at the grocery store. So, this, I think if that was presented to me in a bar, I would say that is a great cocktail.
Told me which is which. I'm assuming this is the preserved.
That's the super
preserved
juice. Yep.
Limes, got it.
I would not look at that and say, oh, you used preserved lime juice. I would say that's a fantastic cocktail.
Yeah. It's got more of the sour to it.
Yeah.
Of the gin sour.
A little more of the acid of the sour. Yeah. Yeah. And then if you were doing a cocktail party, that's the juice from five limes.
That's pretty good.
That's a lot of juice from five limes. And so from a cost-benefit standpoint,
Versus with no loss in quality. Whole lime in this one, almost?
Pretty much a whole lime in just the one cocktail. Yeah.
There you go.
I mean, that's a winner. Definitely a winner. Thank you, Nicole, for taking all of this knowledge that's written out and distilling it into something that's usable today. I mean, that's the genius behind this, is you've taken bits of knowledge that are related but disparate, put them together, and said, this is something amazing, and it is. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon. I might have another little bit of this one.
It's almost gone. Mm-hmm.